Alright, 2012, Module 3, Programming. Let's begin. Briefly describe three stages of the program translation process. There are many stages. I'll just choose the first three that come to mind. Maybe I might list out all. Alright, let's see. First one, program translation process. You have... Right, yeah. Three stages of the program translation process would be... So we have semantic semantic analysis, lexical analysis, code generation. Yeah, those are straightforward. Semantic will be to check to make sure the rules of the language are being followed. The rules of the language are being followed. Yeah. You could also put that as broken down into token. Tokens are also there too. So example, semicolons. Lexical would be to check for the keywords used in language. So example, like printf and whatnot. Code generation would be convert the source code to assembly language. Or a low-level language, if you want to put it like that, it's object code. Those will be brief descriptions. If they could make this an IMAR question and ask you to give things about the tokens and parse tree and all that different stuff, but basically when they say briefly describe, all they want is any three of them, and once you can give one point about it, you should be okay. But the translation processes could be a lot deeper than this. So don't think that this is the most in-depth answer. This is just exam techniques of answering the question that they ask, which is briefly described for 6 marks, 2 marks each. All right, next one, part B would be write a C function which accepts a positive integer n and returns 2 to the n. State any assumptions made. So you're going to have to make some sort of, you're going to have to come up with some sort of solution that will make sense. So let's try int. Right, so int power, int n, right? So we name any function power, which would be like int n, and then you're receiving an integer n, right? Good. So then you have int c is equal to 0, and then we need to put a for loop in place because that for loop has to iterate through some process for us. So we'll say put the c is equal to 0, c less than n, c plus plus, because n is the amount of times that we actually want it to run. And let me see, what would we do inside here? We create a variable called answer because we have to store the answer somewhere. And we could say answer is equal to 2 times the answer. So we multiply the answer back onto itself, because the answer will keep updating every time. So you multiply by 2 each time, and then you return the answer. But we have to start the answer at 1, just in case the n comes in as 1. You have to make sure that, okay, if n comes in as 1, that means the loop will run one time, so we multiply 1 by 2, which will be 2. So, because 2 to the power of 1 will be 2. So, that's why answer has to be set at 1. And then just multiplying the answer by 2 each time, and the loop will keep counting up. There's another way to do it, by counting the loop down, by using C minus minus. And you could just start from C is equal to N and until C is equal to 1. And you would get the same result. There are multiple ways of solving this. Any assumptions that made, my assumption would be that n is a positive integer, where n is a positive integer. But there are other ways of doing this. Most of the times in CompSci, a lot of the questions, there are multiple ways of solving it, but what the examiners look for will be the key components of solving the problem, which would be you have to iterate, you have to create variables, and you have to put some sort of process in place, and you have to return a value because it's a function, and it must have a return type, which is an integer. So that is that's one solution for it. Yeah, but there are others. Alright, part C now is... Let's see, part C. See part 1, write C code to store the even numbers from 2 inclusive to 40 inclusive in a file called num.dat. So we have to store all the even numbers from 2 to 40 inclusive. Right, so that's a for loop on a file. So they just ask for the C code and actually the whole program. So we'll just write the code for it. So we'll declare file out equals fopen num.dat. And we will open it in write mode because it's an output file. That's what the W is for. And we want to go from 2 inclusive to 40 inclusive. So we create a counter and then we go for a for loop from C is equal to 0. Actually, should we start from 0, boy? We should start from 2. I'm thinking we should start from 2 instead. Yeah. C is 2. And less than or equal to 40 because it's inclusive. So you could put less than or equal to 40 or less than 41, whichever one. And then you put in your C++. After you put in your C++, now we want to print it out to the file. So we want to print out only the even numbers. So you could add by 2 or you could use the mod. If you use mod, if you're custom using mod, just use mod. C mod 2 is equal to 0. If C mod 2 is equal to 0, then you just print it to the file. Or you could put in the for loop C is equal to C++2 instead of C++. Your choice. And they'll definitely be checking for the fprintf and using out. And for the %d and C, you're just printing out the value of C if it's an even number. Yeah. If you did a while loop and you put C is equal to C++2, that would work also because... Yeah, multiple ways of doing this, but the core concept is, can you loop through and skip and figure out how to get only the even numbers, and can you print a file? That's what they're basically looking for there. For 5 marks, the 5 marks will probably break down with the file declaration 1 mark, opening it up in write mode, a next mark for being able to loop, and another mark for figuring out how to get to. And then the next mark will be knowing how to print, do a fprintf or print our output file. I think I put 6 marks by mistake. Okay, somewhere along there will be 5 marks. Can't say exactly. But for the most part, no, actually there's 7 marks. Yeah. So yeah, you probably get 1 mark for the for loop and then neatness and indentation will be another mark. Is neatness and indentation or the question just being generally correct? Something like that. All right, so let's see what part 2. Part 2 says, write C code to read the integers from the file num.dat created. And for each integer, okay. All right, so now we're reading from the file. So we call it an input file, file in fopen. num.dat, and we open it in R mode this time, which is read mode. So we're reading it. When we read it, we are going to now say while not end of file, because we don't know any file going to unstop. The file just have random numbers, so we have to use we have to use a loop to know how to get to the end of the file. So while not end of file in, so while we haven't reached the end of the file, what do? We are going to fscanf. So you have to put the fscanf in, and all you're doing is scanning the number. You scan that number into a variable. Oh, I didn't declare the variable. All right, so I'll create a variable called num, int num. So I create int num and we scan it into num, and then printf, we just print back out the value, that's all. Oh no, we add in 5 to it, okay, so num is equal to num plus 5, and you add that 5 to the value that you just read, and then print the result on the screen. So now we could print the num. So that'll be printf percent %d, comma num, because num is the variable. And setting back the num to 0 would be necessary because each number we want to print that number plus 5. So you have to set back the num to 0 each time so that when you read over a new number, you'll be adding 5 to a fresh number, not the result of the previous number from before. Because they didn't say the sum of all the numbers, they say just add 5 to each number. So you'll get one for creating, opening the file, one for knowing how to loop through a file, one for scanning, one for printing, and one for making sure you set the number back to 0. I doubt they'll give it to, yeah, the reason that this is 5 marks is because they don't want to give it 2 marks again for opening the file because they did it in part 1. So they wouldn't really go through that again. Alright, number 6. Explain 3 ways in which good programming style can be maintained. Good programming style can be maintained by 1. Indentation. So you have to indent your code to separate control structures or separate the view of control structures. That's what indentation does. So you know when an if starts, you know when a while starts, stuff like that. Then our next way would be white space, and the other one would be comments. So white space is to make the code easy to read and follow, which is good. And comments will make it easy for other people who are not familiar with the code to read it and understand it. Next, grocer needs to store data about some products using a C application. Each product has an ID, which is an int, a quantity of stock, which is an int, also and a price, which is a floating point, which is a float. So this is a structures question, but they break it down into pieces. Sometimes they'll give you the whole structures question to just write out the answer in the form of a whole program, and then sometimes they'll break it down into pieces like this. So let's start by writing the declaration for product rec. We have the data type, so we're gonna put struct product rec. And the data types that we're going to have inside there would be int for ID. Int ID, then we have an int quantity, then we have a float for price, because product is the actual structure, right? So that'll be part one. That's kind of straightforward. Then declare two variables, item one and item two, that have been recorded. So to declare two variables, you'll just put back the same struct declaration because the struct is the data type. So struct product rec, item one and item two. Item one, item two. Right. Next is to... Oh no, there's another way that you could do it by as soon as you declare the structure, you could put item 1 and item 2 right after it and put the semicolon. That is possible because you would just basically, you create it immediately now, and that kind of makes it global instead of declaring it probably inside a function or something like that. So either one of the two works and you should get a mark to it because both of them are perfectly logical. Alright, next, write C code to put data in item 1 from B above. You could use any values you like, so we basically fill in all the data, so you have to put the dot in between, so it'll be item 1 dot ID is equal to something, I don't know, 001, 2, or 20, whatever. And then item one dot quantity is 5, and then item one dot price. Now the one for the price, you should pass a decimal because it's a float. Even if you don't put it as a decimal, it'll still fill it, but yeah. Assume that the two product extracts, item 3 and 4, already loaded with data, write C code to exchange the values in item 3 and item 4. Alright, item 3 and item 4, they are both structures already. So when you have a structure, you don't have to exchange the values individually. You can just do a normal swap by swapping structures. But to do that, you have to create a temporary structure. So you put struct product rec temp, and that will create a temporary structure. And now you're just doing a standard swap. A standard swap is take the first item and put it inside temp. That's not right, that wrong, something wrong there. Now you have to put item, what do I have here? I have item 3 is equal to temp, item 4 is equal to item 3, item 4 is equal to temp. No, I made a mistake. You have to say temp is equal to item 3 first. So you're basically taking what is in item 3 and putting it inside temp. Let's do that over. So you're taking temp is equal to item 3 or item 4, either one, doesn't matter. And then you'll take what is in 3 and put it in 4, and then what is in temp you will put inside item 3. Yeah. So you could say temp is equal to item 4, item 3, but just remember you're swapping them in the second line, and then in the third line you're replacing the temp with the one that you have just made a copy of. So that would work. The concept of a swap is temp equal to something, two things equal to each other, and then the something is equal to temp at the end. Okay, last question. Now write C code to read a string entered by user at the keyboard, store it in a character array, and print the vowels that are present in the string. If no vowels are present, print no vowels. Assume that the string is entered in uppercase letters and that the string is exactly 7 characters in length. Also count and print the number of occurrences of the letter A in the string. Okay. Example, please enter name Michael. Right, so there's a full program, but they're already testing to see if you know how to use conditions properly. So this could be a little tricky because there are multiple conditions. So we start stdio.h void main, we create our main. And we had to create the word that is exactly 7 characters in length. So they tell us that is exactly 7 characters in length. So we know when we create the word, we put in 7. So char word 7, that means we are able to hold 7 possible characters. And then count is equal to 0. So we go with count equal to 0. Why? Because I have to keep a count of something. There are a lot of things to keep a count of. So we have to count the number of A's. Oh, alright, yeah. So we count the number of A's. So that's why I need a count there. So I'm going to print, enter the 7-letter word. They will allow me to print the 7-letter word. And then I'll scan if the 7-letter word into the string. So I use %s, word, and word. Read it, and semicolon that. And now I have to run a set of ifs. Well, now I have to run a set of ifs to go through them. So I put in a loop in place to go 7 times because I want to go through each location of the array. Because remember, when you scan a string is actually a bunch of characters put in an array that ends in \0. That's really what they're testing here to see if you know that a string is a bunch of characters. And you could go through an array. Well, when you go through an array, which is a string, when you go through a string, what you're really doing is you're checking each letter of that word. So for the first location, which will be word location C, which will start off at location 0, we have to check to see, we'll have to check a long if to see if no vowels are present. So I'm going to say if word location C is equal to A. No, My first condition is supposed to check to see if it's not equal to. Yeah. So I want to check to see, first of all, I want to check to see if it's not a vowel. If it's not a vowel, I need to keep track of that somehow and give them an error message. So I want to check to see if word C is not equal to A. And then at this if now, we'll have to go through all the possible vowels. So they're testing to see if you could use the OR function. Yeah, this will definitely be an OR. So if word C is not equal to A, or not equal to B, or not equal to C, or not equal to D, or not equal, I mean, A-E-I-O-U. A-E-I-O-U, all right, yeah, because there's no vowels. So let's see. If word C is not equal to A, or word C is not equal to E, or word C is not equal to I. You get the picture, right? Or word C is not equal to O. Or word C is not equal to U. Right. If that happens, then, well, basically, I haven't found a vowel. So no vowels. Something I can write about that, but I'll see. So it'll print no vowels once it goes through that first one. Else, we're basically checking to see which one is equal to. So we'll check to see if word C is equal to A. Oh, and they told us to count the number of A's, so this is where the count comes in. So if word C is equal to A, then I will carry up the count by 1. Oh no, before I carry up the count by 1, I have to print A is present. So I'll print A is present, and then I'll carry up the count by 1. And, print F, if is equal to E, I'll print F E. Well, I'm not putting the word vowel E present, because I don't have space to write all that, because these back in these days, papers didn't have lines. So you have to write on paper, so I don't have space. I'm kind of squeezing it in. So then I go through all the vowels. Word C is equal to I, printf I found, and then I'm going down to the O, and eventually I'll get to the U. Right, and yep, that would give me the answer that I want. And then at the end, I'll have to print out the number of A's is equal to count. Yeah, I'll have to print out number of A's equal to count. So printf. Number of A's equal percent D, and then I put in the count. And all of that's supposed to be after the while loop, the for loop is finished. Yeah. So that goes after the for loop. All right, let's double check and see. Let's see what they'll give the marks. They'll give 1 for that, for your variables. Then they'll give 1 for scanning, most likely. Then they'll give 1 for knowing you have to use a for loop to loop through. Then they'll probably give you a next 1 for all of those ifs there. Or for finding a way to print the no vowels. Yeah. Then they'll give one for checking it in and making sure I check the count. And then one for doing all the ifs to see if it's to go through a EIOU. Yeah, and then one to print. Oh, I put num instead of count here. So count is the variable I used, so I put count. So one for printing that out there. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. How am I only getting 9 marks? Oh, 10 for all the statements. And the 11th mark would be for it being correct. I don't know. There may be something I'm missing. Alright, so that should basically be it there. And then at the end of it all, you'd say if NV is equal to 7, then printf, no vowels. Yeah, so if you do the NV, because you know it's 7 times, so if the NV end up being equal to 7, then you would get it, yeah. Alright, so that would fix that problem there. So basically what I will do is, for this one here, I basically go down, put if it's not an A or I or U, I'll say NV++. So I'll create a variable called NV, int NV is equal to 0, and I'll do NV++. And when I'm done here, I'll put a if before this guy here. The if would go like right. This bracket here will go back up. Yeah, so when the whole for loop finish, I'll say if NV is equal to 7, then we will do printf. No vowels. Else printf number of A's. Yeah, because we don't want the number of A's to print out and it come out blank if there were never any A's. So you'll just either print no vowels or you print the number of A's, and if anything else had to print, it would have printed already in the section up there. Alright, cool. Yeah. That solves our problem. Cool, any questions there? So now the change is that we create a variable to hold whenever you get a no vowel output, and you're keeping track of NV going up by 1. And if you don't get a vowel, you carry up NV by 1. Then else you have vowels, so you check to see which vowel it is, print it out. You repeat that loop 7 times, and then you check to see if the no vowels equals 7, you know you got no vowels. Else, print out the number of A's so that your output will show you each one of those. Alright, cool. So I'll see where the last mark will go now. This last mark going down here. Yeah. Alright, good. That was very productive. That would have saved you 1 mark. Maybe 2. For being able to print out the no vowels. Yeah, it would have saved you 2 marks for being able to print out the no vowels. Okay, that takes us to the end of this 2012. So for next class, which will be next week Thursday, you will do the module 1 for 2013, okay? 2013, section A. That's what we'll be correcting next class.